With me on stage, we have a woman who works with robots and exoskeletons, who works on the Internet of Women things, who works in lots of different arts and technology-related projects, who has a CV which would take me several hours to recitate, so I won't do that. This time, she talks about hormones and hysteria, and I'm really looking forward to this. So please give a very warm round of applause to Viola.
Okay, hi. I'm Viola, and I first want to say that I'm not an expert. I've been just looking the topic up for a couple of years, so, and I learned a lot, so I thought I want to share this. And I'm also a little bit afraid, because you're probably all not only interested in this topic, but you're also kind of experts in your own experience and the own things that you looked up on hormones in this topic. So it might be that I'm saying something wrong, or that I've found a source that you think is not reliable at all. So please let me know. So after this talk, we will have a Q&A, and we will have I'll come off the stage, because I like to be in the people and not on the stage. And then we can exchange info that we learned. So I've been now learning for years, and you've been also probably learning a lot. So let's share all this. And then I wanted to do a little bit provocating stuff, because I've thought that hormone troubles need to be understood as soon as possible, because I had a lot of women in my area that had PMS and a lot of hormone trouble. And then you can notice this by other people saying to this woman, like, a woman, you don't make any sense. Well, I thought she was just vulnerable, and then the men should just treat her really nice, or the other people in the area. But so as soon as people are saying this, like, hey, you don't make any sense, or who is this alien and what did you do to my wife? That's typical signs that something is wrong with your hormone balance. And nowadays, I also see a lot of people splitting up, and a lot of kids with split parents. And I think it's not always really nice for kids, and especially not if it's related to hormones. And if you can fix this thing, it would be really awesome. And then I also was thinking maybe it could also be a factor in transgender suicide cases, because according to scientific research, it's 33 to 40% of transgender people attempt suicide at least once in their lifetime, and it's 20 more than average people do. And I think we should understand hormones more, because a lot of people just say, "Oh, this person is crazy," or "This person is just doesn't make sense," or "She's stupid," or "She's a bitch." But people are not evil or are not a bitch. There's always a cause when they do things, and a cause that can be a childhood or a bad experience, but also hormones. So, and also drama in the community last year. When I said also that I was going to have this talk, there were several people telling me, like, hey, I saw examples of this in our community when there was drama, and we're sure that was caused by hormones also. Now, what do I know about hormones? I was thinking, and I'm doing it provocative again. What I know is 97% of Dutch prisoners are male. And when I drink alcohol, especially when I was like 18, I was really happy with drinking alcohol. And then, but I also learned when I was doing sexology at the University of Amsterdam, at the VU University, and later at the UvA, I also studied it there, that drinking alcohol makes your make more testosterone. So that's why the teacher said, like, breezers are there to make the girls more into the mood, more horny, because testosterone makes them more like a bit monkey style. Huh? You know, this men that drink, or the women that drink, they feel more self-confident, and some of them fight more, but a lot of women get more in the mood. And that is all caused by only this testosterone. And then in estrogen, we see actually the opposite of the number, that of the 97% of the Dutch prisoners are male. We see in psychiatry that this number is upside down. So women tend to hurt themselves, or they look at themselves when they get into a fight with their husband, like, what is wrong with me, or hurting themselves. So I thought this might be estrogen and testosterone related. Well, my talk has a focus on that, hormones can sometimes make you feel extra vulnerable. And I notice people around me have no idea it's the hormones doing this. And I think they often still think it's because of the world. We have this big bad world and capitalism, and it's all going to hell. And I have some practical tips and explanation how it's possible. I also put it on Dutch, but I think he'll speak English. When I was in my 20s, like 22 or so, or 21, I made a manual for people. For me, maybe it's a bit geeky, but if I was behaving unreasonable, please feed me chocolate or let me sleep enough. So there was only two things that I needed to have to function well, because I thought I was a nice person, but sometimes not. And then only, trick one is put chocolate in, especially in the night, because I found out later that happens because my sugar levels are low. I never learned it at school, also not from my parents. And having enough sleep for this princess, who is really nice in general, not always, that makes me become a princess again. And then when I was in my 30s, sometimes there were people saying, hey Viola, you're a bit bitchy in your emails. And I was like, well, I'm just reacting. I was just like, and I just type back and then. But then they said, yeah, you are behaving like a bitch. And I didn't feel it like this. Huh? I didn't feel like a bitch at all. I was just thinking, they are sending those emails, or they are sending me those letters. But I thought, I'm a woman, let's seek it with myself, because I cannot change the world always. Let's try to change myself first. So I typed into a search engine, why am I such a bitch? Just checking. So I found some results. And the most appealing thing to me, what I found, is that it could be PMS. PMS is the premenstrual syndrome. It's like the week before your menstruation. You can actually do a couple of tricks for it, like taking monk's pepper. It's on the picture above. And drink enough water or other liquids. And I forgot to drink because I was too busy with stuff, so I drink, but I don't think I got it to 1.5 or 2 liters, maybe 1 liter or so. But that's actually thinking of drinking enough, it's strange how it helps. Perfect. And broccoli, and there were other tips also. So if you want to look it up, you can just search tips for PMS. And it actually took a long time, because after I started to realize this, that I was extra sensitive, still it took me like 3 years or so, that every time when I felt really crap, like my mother died and I had and my job stopped and everything was at the same time. And then every time that I was thinking, now it is getting a little bit too much, and I was thinking like, now it's the horrible, my partner left, and my mom just died, everything at the same time. And then I had some points, and there was also a tax letter coming in of a tax authority making mistakes again, or some, I don't know, washing machine that broke down, and I was like, how can people be so stupid? And I was like, why don't you just leave me alone? And then realizing it's not them, I should take my pill. That was super difficult, because it also was them. Huh? It also was them dying or splitting up or sending a stupid letter in full with mistakes. So it was also them. And then to make that switch in my mind, like, hey, not only the feeling of, what a stupid outside world, it is, what day of the month is it again? So that took a lot of practice. So every incoming message was, a little bit over-sensitive. So, and I didn't see myself as a bitch at all, but just as a super pure creature in this world. It was not me doing the bad things, it was these repair people or the other things that were bad. I was just thinking, oh my God. So this is what you don't feel, like, it's getting a bit too much. And then, maybe the picture on the right could be what other people then perceive, because I think I like all of you have created in like this automatic system of self-protection. Hey, how you do this when you get through your life or as a kid, when you get hurt, you find a self-defense mechanic, and maybe that is also a bit like, ah, leave me alone, it's too much, stop it, it doesn't make any sense, or whatever. And then I was thinking, okay, am I now doing it well? So I was, and then my neighbor on the other side of the street, actually the forest, I live in the street, and in the town with actually 80% women. So it was really nice, but you can also learn of these people a lot. So my neighbor, they had small kids, and they actually split up, the one that had PMS. And I saw really PMS as a cause of it. So I was looking for experts. I found a vrouwen poli. It's called women poli, but you can look it up if you want for more info. And then I heard from the doctor there that I not only once in a while should take that monk's pepper, but I should just do it for a couple of days and then for a couple of months. So every month starting at day 15 of my cycle and then ending just the day before menstruation. Eat more vegetables that have sulfur in it, and they advise the linidol. And I thought, okay, it sounds really technical, but why? And then there was a whole story. I will summarize it a bit. What the woman said, that hormones are fat. Hormones are made out of cholesterol, and people cannot poop or pee out fat, so they need to be water-based. And that is actually done in the liver, making a hormone water oplosbaar, so soluble. So that means that you need to have a water molecule stick to it, so H2O can be split in OH and H, and connecting that to your estrogen makes it water solvable. And the woman doctor said also that she imagined a liver cell as a large fabric hull with a lots of conveyor belts. And then every conveyor belt is connected to a machine, which can do a certain processing. So you have a lot of processes actually in your liver. But then one of these, there are actually three types of conveyor belts or processes that are taking place. And when your liver is, for instance, a bit overworked, you actually use all the three of them. So you have a 2-OH estrone process conveyor belt, a 4-OH estrone belt, and a 16-OH. And when the 2-OH is too full because you get too much crap in your body, for instance, then it has to also use your other two conveyor belts, like this one, when women have like a little bit sensitive breast in their in the time of the month, that means that often that's a sign that this machine is in use a lot. But the last one is the 16-OH, and what does it do? It disables your immune system a bit, because you use this conveyor belt actually only when you are pregnant. And if you get a stress input, like this letter or a stupid husband saying something stupid or whatever, normally when you have a bit of stress, then you want to fight or flight. Eh? That is like a normal reaction. But if you're a pregnant woman and you have this really thick belly, you cannot fight, because you might be punched back in your belly, and that's not so good for the baby, and flighting, running is also not so good for the heavy, doesn't go fast. So the only thing you can do is like, be a bitch. So that is where the bitch behavior is actually comes from. So it's actually really useful, but it's only useful in the case that when you are a pregnant woman. But because this first conveyor belt is too overworked, and then your other ones have to start, so that's the reason why you're being bitch. So there was a lot of advice that I got. Like one of them is take care of your liver. Oh, that's quick, 10 minutes, okay. So medicine and alcohol or alcohol reduce liver working. I actually had it when I was 18 years old. I had a lot of dust allergies. I had antihistamines. It was called Zyrtec at the time, and I really became sleepy. And I found out that especially when I had a couple of beers, then I was like extra sleepy. So alcohol is one of the things that reduce your liver working, so the other machines are in use more. So the first one is too quickly full, so the OH16 one is more use, so the PMS could be stronger. And then other causes with your intestines, Because if your body, if you are taking anything that is difficult to process, like when you have a gluten allergy or some other intolerance for like lactose, then your liver doesn't want to eat it. So I'm really skinny, and it's actually because I'm making a picture because the. When I eat apple pie, I love a lot of pies, but because I have this a little bit of gluten intolerance and I'm a bit sensitive, so it just all got, it really gets like pushed through, and then the liver gets all this food in that hasn't been processed first by the intestines, and it is really busy, so the first conveyor belts are really full, so there's a bigger chance of PMS. When you when it gets too busy in the liver, so I stopped eating gluten for now more than a year, and I tried to take it easy on the milk. What you can also do is to make the 16-OH dysfunctional is methylation. That methyl is CH3. That sticks to a hormone to make it dysfunctional. And actually, a lot of women, often when you see women and men order in restaurants, you also see that men want a big piece of meat, and the women are always looking for vegetables. Not always, but in general, I often see that more. Women order the mint tea on the terrace, and the men are having a beer or something that supports the testosterone. And another trick is to sulfate. When you can connect the 16-OH with sulfur, and sulfur is found when you eat eggs, asparagus, onions, garlic, and cabbages. Then you have other hormones working in your body. You probably know that when you have stress, it also doesn't really work, because then you make a lot of adrenaline, and then the liver is also really busy. But if you try to relax or cuddle, then you get more oxytocin and endorphins. And then it's more relaxed also in your intestines, and you have a bigger food intake, and your organs work also better. So another tip is when you you could support your liver to break down its estrogen by things like nettle tea or other things that help your liver, ginger, a lot of vegetables every day. Another thing is lose extra fats. Moving and sports really helps. Moving is also walking, or it's like using the bike instead of the car for local areas to have a good sleep. Even I actually started doing the daylight lamp in the Netherlands. Take less alcohol and stress. That's what we just said. And if you're like transgender, you can also have like this bitch experiences. I was once in. Going to Burning Man in the US, and one of the people in our RV was a transgender, and we thought, yeah, she was suddenly crying, and she didn't want to go anymore, and we were halfway, and we were thinking, what do we do? And the other people wanted her out, and I just was looking at her, and I asked her, like, what time did you take your estrogens? And she said, yeah, 1 hour ago. And I said, yeah, do you feel extra sensitive? And she said, yes. I said, now, could it be that it's the hormones then? And since then, she took the hormones not in the morning anymore, but in the evening. And she also felt better. So, well, we all thought it was just stress for the Burning Man. So this is what the Dutch guy from our house often looks like. It's often super gray. I always want sun, and it's really gray. So I have this daylight lamp often on, and then blue light filters. I try to sleep at regular times. It's not easy if you don't like any rules, or especially not bedtime rules. Not too much sugars before you go to sleep. Cuddling really works. Oxytocin, even if you cuddle a pillow, but you can also, a lot of people here hug each other and put the hearts next to the heart, and then also squeeze a bit. And you can actually feel that it helps your body to, like, my organs really calm down, and I get more oxygen, and I start breathing in more deeply, and I'm like, whew, and my whole body really likes that a lot. So Actually, that makes the oxytocin in your body. That's the counterweight of the stress hormone cortisol. So if you would cuddle 8 times 30 seconds a day, this is what the doctor advises officially. In the UK, they even have like laws for PMS because they understand it happens a lot. And they give you, there's a law even that you can take 1 day off every month. Because if you are super bitch, then it's maybe also better for the productivity of the people that you are not doing that in the office then. And in other places around the world, there are a lot of cultures where they have a special house on the side of the village where then PMS women can relax in without getting all these stress impulses and feeling them extra heavily. Now, what you can do to check if you want to start, you could check on your folium acids, vitamin B2, vitamin B6, and D. Most people have not enough vitamin D in the Netherlands. You can do an intestine check and a DNA check. Be careful with DNA because of privacy, of course, but I found a German doctor that is under German data protection laws. Can find them via ProHealth, but you have to make sure you ask the results through post, otherwise they could send it via Hotmail and then it's also not safe. You know how that works with privacy and DNA, right? I don't have to explain you. That's a lot of info that you don't want Google data to sell because then they can put your health insurance up in the future because you might have a higher chance of getting disease X or Y, so you want it a secret. That's yeah, you can so it's not about that you have to put your estrogen down, it's about that you have to balance it. Huh? So it's not that you have to like push things away because it all has a function. It's more about balancing it out with other hormones. And yeah, too much exposure to hormone disturbing particles, chemicals, stress, yeah, it's not good. Probably you all know this and it's like common sense in a way, but I really tried it and like eating not gluten when you love to eat every kind of cakes and pies and vlaaien and all this candy and stuff that I always was eating for a year. It took a lot of perseverance, but it helped me a lot. And then I want to learn from you. And I would like to have a discussion also with you because I have no idea if the info I found was like the most complete one and I actually don't really think that. So maybe we can have either a group here, I'll go down or we can go outside or we can have a Q&A now, depends on the time that we still have.
Thank you very much, Viola, thank you. Thanks for ending on perfectly on time. It was awesome. And thanks for the lecture. So eat more vegetables, drink more water, use sunscreen, hug more. We need way more hugging, absolutely. So before I let you off the stage, because you prefer to have a round table or something in the sun, out in the sun, get more sun, but watch out. Do we have maybe one or two questions on the microphone so we have something for the people on the stream?
Yeah, I forgot to add
please,
one.
Please interrupt me.
Yeah, sorry. I wanted to do it really quick and then I forget things. When you do D, I always went to the Kruidvat, which is the cheapest place to get vitamin D for €2. But it's crap. Don't take it. Only works if you take the like half a package, like half the whole pot at the same time. So you have to find the D2000. So you have to really find the accurate things. And this PDF is also on the SHA website. So you can look at the exact things that might help up. And this is all the theories that are found on scientific research on this topic and what you normally have to pay to a doctor to get the same info out.
So any questions or comments, please come to the microphone. Thank you.
Hi, this is super high, hold on. Well, first of all, thank you very much. I found this super interesting. It's a very, I should call it like this. I could also question this concept itself, but a very scientific approach to hormones, which I had no idea about, and I really thank you. But on the other hand, I am from Mexico. So I have this story in mind of a girl that called out her harasser on live TV there was somebody harassing her on live TV on the biggest public broadcaster in Mexico, and a male colleague, and she just stormed out of stage and said, and the male colleague said, "Oh, excuse me," to the audience. He was just apologizing. "Excuse me, my colleague is just hormonal. She's just feeling hormonal."
Yeah.
So my question is, and I think I haven't solved it myself or anywhere near it, but how much is it, and it's a gender thing over and over, how much is it biologically determined and how much is it a social construct used also to oppress women or to oppress...
That's right. Yeah, you're
like,
right.
I was just wondering that because I know there's...
We had a history of hysteria was called a disease. And then every wise woman in the past, like 100 years ago or 70 years ago, they were called hysteric. And it's super bad because if you say, "Oh, my colleague, excuse her," I think that is this testosterone behavior. So I could also say the same thing about this guy. So yeah, we can, I mean, calling names is super stupid, but also calling women hysteric is super stupid, but it's really good to think, could it be this? Because then we can put broccoli in or chocolate in. And then, so yeah, so I'm always not like pointing fingers at people because that doesn't make any sense. And if you say, "Excuse my colleague," that is just attacking people or saying, "Oh, it's a woman." It's also stupid. And it has been abused and it's super stupid. And women have been getting, in 1972 was the last phase that women were finally independent. Eh? They had 1972, that's really late, that they could, have their own money and be responsible over their own finance. But despite our history, I think we cannot call it a taboo, that we cannot name hysteric things anymore, but it's good to do research on it and to help each other. Like not pointing and abusing it, but analyzing and helping and seeing and recognizing it, because this woman doesn't feel like a bitch. She is feeling like it's all getting too much, so she needs a hug. And the only thing she needs to hear is, "Oh, I see you're having it super difficult now." This is exactly the thing that she wants to hear, because this is what she perceives. And not like, "Oh, she is stupid," or "She is hysteria," because that is so super mean, and it doesn't help at all.
Any further questions, comments?
And it's not only women, eh? I mean, sorry, maybe I should have said that too. Men also have estrogens. I mean, in general, it's that men have, in general, more testosterone than estrogen. And then maybe I also had a bit more testosterone because as a kid, I was doing mathematics. I was programming since 6. I was doing climbing trees, making fires everywhere in the neighborhood. So all our hormones go everywhere up and down, but men also have these estrogen peaks. So it's typically, yeah, I now speak about women, but men have these things. A lot of people have these things, but we have to learn to recognize them, not by pointing fingers, but just to recognize this.
Well, no, nobody's lining up at the microphone, so I would say, let's take this outside into the sunshine, get some vitamin D, and please give a warm round of applause for this awesome talk. Thank you very much.